That Dustin will be now the second one.
So I guess I should start by thanking you for coming back after lunch. I know you didn't have to. Where we stopped is we were going through and normalizing the symmetric group on G. GL is just the automorphism group of G times GL. Before we get to the proof, let's sort of observe that this answer is hardly terribly shocking. You know that GL is in the normalizer of GL, and you know that conjugation induces an automorphism. So if you're normalizing things, that's going to be very involved with the automorphism group and group. So this is hardly surprising. The proof, again, it's one of these things where you do the right computation, you're done. So let's see what the proof is. So I'm just going to pick something that's in the normalizer. Well, I want to show that this thing is related to an automorphism of the group. An automorphism of the group always fixes the identity. So what I start with very well may not be an automorphism because it might just not fix the identity. But since the left regular representation is transitive, I can find some H so that when I compose it with delta, it takes the identity to the identity. So that's the first thing I need to do. And I'm just to cut down on the number of symbols, I'm going to let beta be this delta HL. So it's the thing I picked. I made sure that I wasn't being stupid by making sure that it fixed the identity. All right, so let's define a lambda from G to G. It's sort of the obvious thing. I'm going to have lambda G be equal to K if and only if, when I conjugate little GL by beta, I get K sub L. So this is hardly surprising because I'm just conjugating. That's what the normalizer does. And what this lambda is, it is the automorphism of G induced by conjugation by delta. And it maps the identity to the identity as well. And that's actually really easy to see because if that's 1, then beta inverse 1 beta is 1. So, okay. What I want to show you is that beta is actually equal to lambda inverse. That will pretty much do it. So, how do we do this? So, what's beta inverse GL beta? Well, I've rewritten it. There's not really much thought going on here because what? We set lambda of G is equal to K and beta inverse GL is KL. So I'm really just doing a substitution here because I need to change the symbols. So not much is going on there. Beta inverse GL beta is lambda of G, so L. Also, if you take X and G, lambda inverse GL lambda of X, well, let's do the obvious thing. Okay, what is the obvious thing? All I did was look at GL lambda of X. Thinking of lambda of X as an element of G, I just multiply it on the left by G. Okay, now I'm going to do what I claim is the next obvious thing. Lambda is an automorphism, so lambda inverse is an automorphism. These G and lambda of X are elements of G, so I can apply lambda inverse to G and lambda inverse to lambda of X. And, okay, now this really is the obvious thing. The lambda inverse lambda cancels, and I get lambda inverse G X. Great. What does that tell me? It tells me that lambda inverse GL lambda is lambda inverse G sub L. Okay, so there's sort of one of the computations we need. All right, so let's look at this one, and this will sort of be our final computation. So beta inverse lambda inverse GL lambda beta. Well, we know what lambda inverse GL lambda is. So I'll just substitute that, and I get lambda inverse of G, so L, beta. But I know what conjugating by beta does. So I'll just substitute that. So I get that this is lambda of lambda inverse. inverse of G sub L. And of course the lambda is canceled again. This gives me G L. So there's our magic computation. And what this tells me is that lambda beta centralizes G L. Right? Because if you you can multiply by that thing on the other side. And it fixes the identity. Okay, so let's see what it is. Let's pick a G. So G is GL of 1, right? Didn't do anything there, just 2 times 1. Alpha beta centralizes, so I can sort of stick it in, and it maps 1 to 1. Since it centralizes, I can swap it. And GL of 1 is G. So lambda beta of G is just G. And that says that lambda beta is the identity. Because what? It fixes each G. The only thing that does that is the identity. So lambda of beta is the identity. And beta is lambda inverse. And lambda inverse was an automorphism. So beta is an automorphism. And this does it because, what? If you think about what beta was, beta is HL. So if you're wondering where the HL comes from, it's that HL at the very beginning that we used to fix the identity. And then this says that beta is normal. All right. So there's that. Not terribly surprising. Let me actually go back a little bit to remind you of where we were in the problem. So let's get back to all of this. What we were playing with, our general strategy, what we saw was that if delta is an automorphism between gamma and delta that both contain G in its automorphism group, then delta inverse G delta was in the automorphism group. Then we saw that the idea to make the automorphism the isomorphism the enemy gives us better is to compose it with automorphisms of the first graph, and we saw that what that does to delta inverse G delta is basically just conjugates it by the automorphism of gamma. And then we considered the nicest possible case, and this was when we could actually conjugate and get G back. And so then we calculated the normalizer, and that was where we were. And so I think there's a lemma at the end of this. Da, 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 da. All right, so now let's return to our isomorphism. Under the hypothesis that since we're assuming the nicest possible case, we know that delta gamma normalizes GL, and so we can write delta gamma as alpha GL for some alpha in the automorphism group of G and some GL. Now, if we're continuing to go here because we can make our solution a little bit nicer because this GL is always in the automorphism group of the Cayley graph. So, as this GL is in the automorphism group, we can basically get rid of it. We can apply G inverse L first, cancel the GL, and just have alpha. So if you summarize all of this, what you get is the following result. Oh, I shouldn't have, this should not be, yeah. So yeah, this is right, sorry. So let gamma delta be isomorphic Cayley digraphs of G. Delta from gamma to delta and isomorphism. If we can find a gamma in the automorphism group such that this gamma inverse delta inverse GL delta gamma gives me back GL, then gamma and delta are isomorphic by a group automorphism of G. So, great. That's an if. The converse is also true. The converse is actually the easy direction. So let's see the whole thing. So I'm going to start with exactly the same hypothesis that I had before.
gamma and delta are isomorphic Cayley digraphs with delta from gamma to delta in isomorphism. And these will be isomorphic by a group automorphism of G if and only if we can find this little gamma in the automorphism group of capital gamma that conjugates the conjugate back to GL. So we only have, if you want to prove this, all you have to do is the other direction. You did that if they're conjugate, then we have the nice automorphism. So let's do the other direction. And like I said, this is the easier direction. So suppose that they're isomorphic by something in the automorphism group. So alpha is an isomorphism. Well, remember that in the hypothesis, delta from gamma to capital delta is an isomorphism, so its inverse is an isomorphism. And now we get the great picture. I'm going to map gamma to capital delta via the group automorphism. And then I'm going to map it back to gamma using delta inverse. And so I've gone from gamma to gamma, so I have an automorphism of capital gamma, alpha delta inverse. And then you can just check. We know that alpha normalizes GL, and you do the computation, you get back GL. The converse is true. Okay. Let me, there's some things I'm supposed to show you. So let's pause here for a minute, and I'll just sort of show you something. I don't know if it's interesting, but you'll notice the 19 is in red. I think these notes are going to be posted, so y'all will be able to take these away. That's actually a hyperlink. It will take you to lemma 19, which I think, this is Beamer. Y'all play with Beamer. It's a little weird. It doesn't actually take me back to the lemma. It takes me back to the slide that the lemma is on. So I click the hyperlink, and then I have to, there it is at the bottom. Okay, so the hyperlink for lemmas, it's not going to take you straight to the lemma, but it will take you to the page, the slide where this is. Also, as we go along, I was asked about if I would give people some citations, some papers to look at. Everything that's cited here, the references are at the end, so you can't see them yet, and those are hyperlinked as well. So if you're looking for references, it's all here. Alright. There's only one little problem with this lemma, and that is that it is not in our fancy terminology about CI. So let's write it in with that terminology. So let G be a group. S containing G, the following are equivalent. The first condition is that the graph I'm looking at is a CI digraph of G, and the second is this conjugation condition. Whenever you take a delta in SG, such that delta inverse GL delta is less than or equal to the automorphism group, I can find an element of the automorphism group that conjugates the conjugate back to the original GL. And this is the format that this result is usually stated in. I haven't attributed this particular lemma to anyone, although historically and traditionally it's Bye-Bye is giving credit for this. The reason I didn't say that this was due to Bye-Bye is because there was a version of this done in the late 20s and 30s for, I talked about designs. Did they have a version of this back then? The answer was yes. Have other people come up with versions of this? The answer is also yes. But in a minute, there will be something that's Bye-Bye. Here it is. So G be a group, following equivalent. G is a CI group with respect to digraphs. And then our condition always works. So the difference between the first lemma and the second lemma is that the CI changed from digraph to group. And the only difference is you have to be able to do this for every Cayley digraph of the group. And here I did give the citation there. So let me just show you the fascinating thing that will happen if you click on the three.
There you go. So there's my vice paper. Now we'll go back.
So yay.
They're all back.
Oh, let's prove something's a CI group.
You know, did y'all notice I haven't told you whether the conjecture is true or not? It's not. But it's almost true in the sense that, well, in almost every sense. It's true for most integers, and you also have to work pretty hard to make it false.
But let's see the first positive result. This was by Turner, 1967. Do you remember the year that the conjecture was made? It was 1967. So did Turner know about the conjecture? The answer is actually no. He was interested in a different problem, a problem of Harari's. Harari was big on enumeration in the 60s, and the problem he asked was to enumerate vertex transitive graphs of a given order. And if you want to enumerate things, then you better be able to solve the isomorphism problem. So let P be a prime, ZP is a CI with respect to digraphs. All right, let's prove this, because the proof is actually not very far. Okay, so we're in SP. P is a prime. If you're in SP, the order of SP is, of course, P factorial. So the highest power of P that divides P factorial is P. ZPL is isomorphic to ZP. It has order P. So it's a Celo P subgroup of SP. Forget the automorphism group. We're just looking at SP. But if you take the automorphism group, that's going to be a subgroup of the symmetric group. I skipped ahead a little bit. Let's pick our connection set. Let's pick our delta. The conjugate is contained in the automorphism group. Then this conjugate and the original ZPL are Celo P subgroups of SP. So they're certainly Celo P subgroups of the full automorphism group. So they're conjugate in the automorphism group, and we're done by the lemma. So it's just a nice, straightforward application of the Celo theorems.
Great.
The next question I'm supposed to ask is, what did I do with digraphs here? The only place digraphs were actually mentioned was when I picked my, because it's a theorem about digraphs. I never used any graph structure. So the question is, why can't you do this theorem, just erase the word digraph and stick in your favorite combinatorial logic? The answer is you can do that. It works. As a matter of fact, all of this that we've just done today works. So with almost identical proofs, and when I say almost identical, I literally mean erase the word graph or digraph, scribble in your favorite combinatorial object. And this one is definitely attributed to Bye-Bye because he was the first one, I guess, to realize the generality that this argument has. So G be a group, K a class of combinatorial objects, and X a Cayley object of G in K. The following are equivalent. X is a CI object of G, and then we have, I even forgot. See, I told you I had to scribble out the Cayley and the graph. I forgot. You guys got it all with me? I've got Cayley GS there. That should be an X. And this tells you how serious I am about just cutting and pasting things. So that should be an X. Oh, I've got an X there. Yay. Okay. Exactly the same. Exactly the same result. Again, just have a class of combinatorial objects, not just graphs or digraphs. And this is also due to Bye-Bye. And the new question arises, if the class of combinatorial objects doesn't matter, can't you actually ask, what about all of them at the same time? So here's a definition. Your G, which is a CI group with respect to every class of combinatorial objects, is called a CI group. And notice that I say always with respect to digraphs, with respect to graphs. When I just say CI group, that just means you don't care what the object is. You always have this nice CI property. Here's theorem 28, so PD of prime, CP is a CI group. How do you prove this? You do exactly the proof that you had before. You just scratch out the Cayley graph, you put in the Cayley object X of G. That's it.
So CI groups. Oh, there's one thing I wanted to sort of point out about this, that there's a couple things. One, I was thinking about this, let me go back. I was thinking about this in the break, and I think this was something that I've gotten very, very used to, but it sort of freaked me out when I first started studying this. Where did our question start? Our question started with, okay, I'm going to give you a gamma and a delta, and I'm going to morphologize a morpher. Now here I have this nice lemma, and where's the other graph? I'll see what I'm getting at. This is sort of crazy, because you start with a gamma and a delta, and then all of a sudden it turns into something where you only have to look at gamma, you never have to look at delta. So it's a little crazy. And in reality, once you knew that it was a CI digraph, what you would do is just look at all its images, and then you just check and see if delta's on the list. So it's a little, like I said, I always found that a little crazy. The second thing is, at the very beginning I was telling you that I was a little worried that maybe perhaps this problem was a little too narrow, and that in the course of this preparing this talk, it became quite clear again that this was not a narrow problem. The reason being is there's a very natural question if you are interested in symmetries of graphs, and that is, well, what is the automorphism group? And if you think about what this says, this tells you that if you want to solve the isomorphism problem, you don't have to know the full automorphism group, but you have to know a lot of information about the full automorphism group. You need to know quite a bit about it. And in reality, for the classes of Cayley graphs where people have calculated the full automorphism group, solving the isomorphism problem is basically almost always done first. So another way of thinking of this problem is that it's sort of a step towards calculating the full automorphism group, which is typically, the full automorphism group is hard even after you solve the isomorphism problem, but it definitely helps a lot of cases. All right, so let's get back to where we were. We were doing all this general stuff. We have the CI groups. ZP is a CI group. All right, so now we're going to go back. That's the end of this nicest case where we're looking at Cayley graphs. So let's go back to the general case. I'm sort of going to go back in steps. So I'm going to step back away from regular groups. I'm still going to have transitive groups. But I'm not necessarily going to have a regular group. I'm going to have G is transitive, H is going to be the stabilizer of a point. The normalizer here, and remember, once we know the normalizer, we will be able to figure out if there are nice isomorphisms. So the question is, you know, can you calculate the normalizer in this case? The answer is yes. It's a little bit different. You let A bar, for lack of a better notation, be the subgroup of the automorphism group of G, which consists of all automorphisms of G, which map the stabilizer to the stabilizer. Then basically the normalizer is the same thing. It's going to be this A bar times G. Notice here N is the number of points that we're permuting, like before. Okay, so if you back off from having a regular group to having a non-regular group, basically the same program works through. For intransitive G, you can compute the normalizer, I think. I don't think anybody's ever written it down. It's sort of ugly looking. I thought about, you know, could I do it? And the answer's yes, you just have to play with the orbits, and the orbits are transitive, so they will be regular, in which case you know what the normalizer is. They will not be regular, in which case you know what the normalizer is. And then if two of the orbits
the actions are the same, then you can permute them, stuff like that. So
intransitive, you can still handle, but the statement is complicated. All right, let's go back farther back still. The first simplifying assumption we made was that we can always conjugate and get our g back. Let's suppose that that doesn't work. Are you dead in the water? The answer is no. So rephrasing this, there's just more than one conjugacy class of G in the automorphism group. What do you do here? Well, you find all the conjugacy classes, and let's suppose of G in the automorphism group, and let's just suppose for simplicity that G is in this first conjugacy class. Well, then you're just going to need to find these other elements, S1 to Sn, that take the conjugacy class you're in to the one that your G is in. And then delta and gamma will be isomorphic by something that looks like this. There's terminology that goes with this. I think Misha will talk about that on Thursday. These are called solving sets. So I guess the point being is that if you can figure out the conjugacy classes of the subgroup, the special subgroup G or GL, whatever it happens to be, then you can solve the isomorphism problem. And typically, if you can figure out what the conjugacy classes are, that's sort of the hard part. If you can do that, you can typically find the S and I's. And I'm saying that not because I have a proof of that, but because it has not yet happened where people have the conjugacy classes and could not find the S and I's. The conjugacy classes are hard. All right, so there is, I guess, the end of the beginning. Before we go on, I'm going to have to teach you some permutation theory. Just to give you an idea of where we're going, we saw that ZP was a CI group, right? And that proved, quite frankly, once we had the machinery, the bye-bye characterization, it was very easy to just comment. As your group gets bigger, life gets harder, and we need more tools than just the CELO theorems. Ultimately, and by larger, of course, I don't mean in absolute size. What complicates things here is not the absolute size, because what? Primes can be arbitrarily large. Primes are easy. What's the next simplest case? Well, it's the product of two primes. So what I would like to eventually show you is that ZP cross ZP is a CI group with respect to digraphs, that ZP squared is not, and that ZPQ for P and Q distinct primes are. These results are accessible enough, but they will also give you an idea of the flavor of the way the arguments go, and you'll also get an idea of the structure of how the proofs go. So we need to sort of take a hiatus and study permutation. All right, so I'm going to start with the primitive permutation theories. So let's let G be a transitive group acting on the set X. A subset B is called a block of G. If whenever you take an element of G, then G of B intersect B is empty or it's B. I'll give you a picture of a graph in just a minute. You'll be able to see some blocks very easily, but there's a bunch of terminology and stuff that goes with this. There are trivial blocks. If you take a singleton set, well, guess what? A singleton set is always either mapped to itself or somewhere else. And the whole set itself is always mapped to itself or somewhere else. These are blocks, but they're boring. So we're trivial, we'll call them trivial. Nobody cares about the trivial blocks, we want non-trivial blocks. Any other block is non-trivial. If you have a non-trivial block, then your group is said to be primitive.
Primitive. If it's not primitive, it's primitive.
Primitive groups are, just to sort of give you an idea of why you might break it down, think about primitive and imprimitive. Primitive groups are pretty well known exactly. one level of the classification defined supergroups. There's a theorem called the O'Mahon-Scott theorem, which tells you how to construct all of the primitive groups with their actions, etc. So if you're walking down the street and you want to run into a primitive group, you have somewhere to start your problem. You can always get the O'Mahon-Scott theorem out together with the classification of the finite simple groups and the way to go. So this primitive versus imprimitive, it's sort of a very standard, nice way to start. I am not an expert on the classification of finite simple groups, so I'm not going to say I avoid the primitive case altogether, but my strategy is to get out of the primitive case as soon as possible. And primitive groups, to me, are much more natural. Oh, on with the terminology. If I find a block, what about the image of a block? Is it going to be a block? The answer is yes, it's called a conjugate block. Conjugate block. Conjugate. 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 You've all seen that word before, right? It's chosen purposefully here. And we'll see that. The set of all blocks conjugate to the block you found, I'm going to call it, I guess, script B. This forms a partition of your set. And it's called a complete block system. I was going to talk to a very much more famous mathematician than me asked the question, why do you call it a complete block system? Are there incomplete block systems? Y'all with me? You take some of them, but not all of them. And my answer to him is going to be the same to you. I call these complete block systems because the first paper I read on this topic called them complete block systems. And for many years, the only book on permutation group theory was by Wieland. He wrote a book, I think, in 1963. And I don't know if he called them complete block systems, but the person who translated that book into English called them complete block systems. So I don't care about the terminology. I'm going to use this just because it's what I use. Other people will use a system of imprimitivity. That makes sense. And probably the one that is most descriptive is a gene-variant partition. So I think the complete block system is going the way of the dodo, and eventually it'll just be, I think gene-variant partitions will win, but I'm going to use a complete block system because...
I have a question.
Sir?
Could you guys remove the word all?
Yeah. But his question for me was, when do you not play with all of the blocks? It's like, well, you know, I guess you... Well, I have an okay answer now, but I had no answer. But I guess the point I was trying to get at is that the terminology is, people fight about it, not with swords or anything like that, but they do fight about it. All right. Let's see an example. Yay, everybody likes examples. Here's a Cayley graph on Z6. The connection says 2, 3, 4. I think I drew it correctly there. Do you see anything that might look like a block? Can I give you a hint? How about the triangles? How many triangles are there? There's one there. There's one there. These things going across here are not triangles. So I picked this graph because there are two triangles. And you know that the image of a triangle under a graph automorphism has to be a triangle. So what about, we know the automorphism group is transitive because it's a Cayley graph. So what about this triangle? It has to stay where it is, or it has to be mapped to that triangle. And those two things have no vertices. So in graph theory, this is a nice way of actually finding blocks. You find some subgraphs that are isomorphic. You know that they're permuted, and if they form a partition, you'll actually get a block system. There's another block system here.
Edges.
The edges, because when you take the triangles out, right? The, so what he means by edges is the edges across 2, 5, 0, 3, 1, 4. When you take the edges out, of course, edges that are not in triangles have to be mapped to edges that are not in triangles. So the edges between the two triangles have to be mapped to the edges between the two triangles. This is all a matching.
Yeah, it's another clause.
So, two triangles, map a triangle to a triangle. We have two blocks of size 3. The edge is not in the triangle, they're mapped to themselves. We have a complete block system with three blocks of size 2.
Now, the last statement is perhaps a little mysterious.
Now we can see that the full automorphism group is S2 cross S3. There's a little bit more to argue. You see where the S2 is? It's the triangles back and forth. Where's the S3? It's permuting the three edges. And now all you have to do is argue that, well, if you tell me where a triangle goes and you tell me where, if you tell me where the triangles go, you tell me where these edges across go, then you've actually uniquely determined the permutation. Yay, we get S2 cross S3. One of the things that we're going to see, and this is going to be a theorem which I'm not going to prove because it requires a big pile of definitions. And it's actually a pretty intuitive result. It's called the embedding theorem. Is it clear that we've got a coordinatization going on here? We can talk about 0, 1, 0 triangle. It's the one you pick first, the one triangle. Then the edges are, say, Z3, so you could naturally think of this graph, independent of the labeling I've chosen, as being in Z, the vertex at Z2 cross Z3. In other words, each of these block systems gives me a coordinatization of the group that I'm looking at. If you have a block system to translate that, if you have a complete block system, you can always not only think of the transitive permutation group you started with, but the induced action on a block system. It permutes the blocks as well as the points.
Okay.
Oh, little definition. The degree of a permutation group is just the number of points that it permutes. Overused term. Some basic theorems. I don't think I even proved this, Dr. No, I don't. Theorem 32. So let me read it. B is a script B is a block system. Every block has the same cardinality. Yeah, because what? How do you get all the blocks? You start with a block, you look at its image, so you don't change its size. It forms a partition. So if you tell me there are m blocks of size k, the degree must be m times k. Okay, so that's actually very useful. Because it counts then to the, okay. So when I will start working on one of these problems, I already told you I like to avoid primitive groups. That is not always possible. So sometimes I do have to work with them. But the first thing that I would like to do is get myself some blocks. Because believe it or not, this coordinatization I was talking about, I find that to be very, very useful. Group theorists don't like you to label things, but here it seems to help me. So let's look at finding blocks. It's theorem 33 is, this is sort of the most common method that people will use to find blocks. So you want to have a transitive group. If you can find a normal subgroup, then the orbits in, the orbits of the normal subgroup will form a complete block system of G. Oh, and do you remember what, we started with a block, right? And then we looked at its image, yeah? And the image was called a conjugate block. Did you sort of see where the n-normal conjugate,
all that's coming together?
All right, let's prove this, because the proof is not very hard. So let's pick ourselves a point. let's pick an orbit of n that contains the point. And what that means is that b is equal to the images of x under the elements of n, right?
That's just rewriting what an orbit is.
Okay, so let's pick a g and g. And an h and n. Maybe I should have called that n. Let's denote by h prime the element of n such that gh equals h prime g. Or if you prefer, so it's just a constant. Of course, h prime always exists, and that h prime such that h is in n equals n, because conjugation by g induces an automorphism. All right, so let's look at what g of b is. Okay, so. Oh, I guess I should have had pauses here. Oh, well, it doesn't really matter. First equality, where does that come from? Well, b was equal to the set of all h of x's such that h is in n. So all I'm doing is composing g with each of those h's. The next one, the reason I wrote gh equals h prime g instead of gh g inverse h prime is that I now want to swap the order, which I can do, but h changes to an h prime. Well, that's h of g of x such that h is in n. Is that one okay? That I can replace the h prime of h. I can do that because it's for all h. And of course, all the h's are the same as all the h primes. Well, that just means that g of b is the orbit of n that contains g of x. And so the orbits of n, they do form a partition. And well, okay, we know the orbits form a partition. That's a basic fact from group theory, which I won't prove here. And so that, what, they have to be equal or the same. And we've got, here's a block. Every conjugate block is an orbit. The orbits form a complete block system of G. This is the, like I said, this is the most powerful, most commonly used method for finding blocks. And for our purposes in this whole course, all the block systems that we see will be formed by the orbits of normal subgraphs. In real life, that is not the case. It is not the case that all invariant complete block systems are formed by the orbits of normal subgroups. If you look at the line graph of the Petersen graph, that's the easiest example. I don't really want to go there. That's a different kettle of fish. But for us, this is the way you want to think about where your blocks come from. All right. Ah, there's some corollaries. So here's our first one. A transitive group G of prime degree is primitive. Primitive, there are no blocks. Okay. So how do we do this? This is actually really easy. If I give you a prime, what are its divisors? The one and the prime of P. What do you know about the block, the size of the block? We saw before that the number of points was equal to the number of blocks times the size of the block. And since we have 1 and p, yeah, the only choice for a size of a block is 1, in which case it's trivial because it's a singleton, or it's p, in which case it's the whole thing, and that's trivial too. Okay, so this is a nice result. Well, there's a typo. There's a big typo. I would have thought I would have spotted that. There's a simple correlation. Ignore this primitive group that appears twice. I don't know how that got there. A non-trivial normal subgroup of a primitive group is transitive.
So a non-trivial normal subgroup of a primitive group is transitive.
Okay, what if you have a normal subgroup of a primitive group? What do we know about its orbits? They're blocks. But primitive groups don't have real blocks. They just have the fake blocks. Either the whole set and singletons. But I said non-trivial normal subgroup, so I've thrown out the singletons. So there's one block, it's the whole set, and that's what it means for a group to be transitive, right? That I can map any point to any other point. Rephrased, the group has one orbit, and that's the group.
So the G, a primitive and a normal subgroup. We go by contradiction. Suppose it's not transitive. The orbits form a complete block system. Script B is non-trivial, so it's imprimitive. That's a contradiction. Sure.
You have to say primitive permutation. Otherwise, you could have something in the kernel.
Yes. Thank you. Do you understand his question? I have a bit of a typo here. I need my primitive group to be faithful. To act faithfully. Now, the reason I forget this is because I have a very hard
time. Group action, you have a primitive group.
Yeah. This is.
You have a primitive group.
Yeah. So there's a small can of worms here, and as Shafiq pointed out, it's the difference between group actions and permutation groups. With a group action, you can have it be unfaithful. It can be something in the kernel. When you take a group from the symmetric group, you know that its action is faithful. And for this result to be true, I need my group to be a permutation group. I can't have. It's not true to say I've got a primitive action on a set. Okay? Let me just give you a quick example of a primitive group acting on a set with a non-trivial kernel. And it's, take the automorphism group here. We talked about how, what the automorphism group is S2 cross S3. We talked about how if you have blocks, the group can permutes the blocks. So you can think of the full automorphism group acting on the triangles. And to act unfaithfully, that would just mean that you were fixing both triangles. And are there non-trivial automorphisms that do that? The answer is yes. What, just this, we'll add 2 modulo 6. We're just thinking about rigidly permuting the 2 triangles. Does it make sense? So is everybody happy with this question and why I'm sort of nodding, but this is actually sort of nice because what I was telling you earlier that all of our this is a nice example to come back to. I was telling you that for us, all of the complete block systems that we're going to run into are formed by the orbits of normal subgroups. So our triangles here, is there a normal subgroup of the automorphism group that gives you that? Yes, of course, it's the S3. For the other one, it's the S2. And if you think about what the kernel here certainly contains what? X goes to X plus 2. So it contains a subgroup of the left regular representation, which here just adds 1. The other kernel, if you look at these edges, we got 2 and 5, the difference is 3, the difference is 3, the difference is 3. So what's in that kernel is going to be the map that takes x to x plus 3, which is again a subgroup of the left regular representation. Okay, and again, this is something we'll be seeing later, so it's good to sort of pause and laugh about it for a little bit. All right, let's see. Here we are. is it's sort of a little out of character for this talk. I'm going to give you in graph theory, this is sort of the canonical example. This is the Peterson graph. So to start with, I'm going to define two permutations, rho and tau. They're going to map z2 cross z5 to z2 cross z5. Rho is going to add one in the second coordinate. And remember, that's modulo 5. So that's going to be a product of two 5 cycles. Tau, it's going to map I, j to I plus 1, 2j. And let's look at the Peterson graph labeling here. If you think about what this rho does, notice that there's the outside and the inside natural 5 cycle with the Peterson graph. Those I've labeled with 0 and 1. So what rho does is it adds 1. So it takes this inside 5 cycle and just commutes it like so. Rho does the same thing to the outside. Now what does tau do? Well, tau, it maps the outside 5 cycle to the inside 5 cycle and vice versa, but it's got to twist things because the 5 cycle isn't the same. That's what this 2 does. If you're familiar with the terminology, this is basically just saying that the Peterson graph is a 2-5 metacircle. These were introduced by Alsbach and Parsons, mainly because of the Peterson graph, actually. Okay, so you can check here to check that rho and tau are both automorphisms. You actually do have to check all of the edges, because this is not a Cayley graph. Rho tau is not a regular group. Tau actually has order 4, because 2 times 2 is 4. So when you fix with tau, when you square it, you're going to fix the outside 5 cycle, the inside 5 cycle, and you're just going to reflect, like so. That's what it's going to do. All right, what about tau inverse? You can actually just calculate what it is. What does it do in the first coordinate? It adds 1. So to undo that, somewhat shockingly, you subtract 1. It multiplies by 2 in the second coordinate. How do you undo multiplication by 2? Well, you divide by 2 and mod 5, that's multiplying by 3. And there's actually the formal computation. This is not terribly complicated. So tau inverse rho tau, what's this? Okay, so I'm in the first equality, I'm just going to apply tau, so it's I plus 1, 2j. Now I'm going to apply rho, so I add 1. Now I'm going to apply tau inverse. And in this step, notice I didn't do anything clever, I didn't do any arithmetic. I just said, okay, I'm going to subtract 1 in the first coordinate, multiply by 3 in the second. That's I, j plus 3. So the point here is that tau inverse rho tau goes to rho cubed. And so rho, the subgroup generated by rho, is normal in the subgroup generated by rho tau. So the orbits, these are the outside and inside 5 cycles. They form a complete block system. So I just wanted to give you a concrete example where I give you a group. It's contained in the automorphism group. We calculate, find a normal subgroup. This gives us blocks. And since I'm almost out of time here, let me point one last thing out. The full automorphism group of the Peterson graph is not imprimative. There are automorphisms which take the outside 5 cycle to somehow runs the lace in and out. So do not think that I'm saying the automorphism group of the Peterson graph is imprimitive. I'm telling you that there's a subgroup proper that is imprimitive. And I'll stop there.
Yeah, thank you, Dave. Are there any questions or comments? Okay, let us thank the speaker.